Now, let's talk about humanism. The humanistic approach to learning refers to a wide variety of ideas and techniques. While there may be interpretations, they all advocate humanizing the teaching and learning. Okay? The learner is a person who has feelings, attitudes, and emotions. Emotions such as self-efficacy, self-assurance, intrinsic and extrinsic motivation determines how the student approaches learning. However, not all emotion facilitates learning. Stress and constant fear have a profound effect on learners' ability to think and learn effectively. Past experience such as grades and failures have major impact on students' current ability to learn. From the humanistic perspective, the notion of belongingness as an important part to be incorporated in a curriculum design. A good curriculum creates an environment that is inclusive. Every member of the community feels that they are equally an equal member of the community and has equal say to contribute to the learning environment or teaching and learning environment. This is very important, particularly in schools that are geographically located within a single ethnic setting. For example, it could be an environment where students are mostly Chinese. So the question is, if you sit in a situation where most of the students are Chinese, then how do you create the environment to accommodate the non-Chinese? And not only from race, because it could be from religion. It could be from disabled. How do we keep the school environment that is inclusive of the disabled? Or people with learning disability, how do we orchestrate our teaching and learning activity that allows people with learning disability to participate in a meaningful way without being marginalized? So the humanistic approach to psychology, or the foundation to curriculum design, brings in the human element into the thing. So we had the three elements we talked about earlier, the behavioral element, the cognitive element, and now the humanistic element. The three prominent or noteworthy personalities who had an impact on the emergence of the humanistic psychology are Abraham Maslow, Carl Rogers, and Arthur Coombs. Now let's talk about what Maslow talked about. He observed that humans are constantly striving to control their behavior and seeking to gratify themselves. He proposed his well-known theory called the Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs in 1943. According to this theory, individuals satisfy their needs as follows. So he talked about six levels. The first one, survival needs. You're needing water, food, air, and proper rest. Safety needs. You need to feel safe. You should avoid danger. You shouldn't feel threatened. Okay. The third one, belongingness and love. Gaining affection of the people and needs to belong to a group. Then the fourth one is esteem. Need to be recognized and feel worthwhile. And the fifth one, knowing and understanding needs. The desire to know, learn and understand things. And the final one is self-actualization. To develop one's full potential to fulfill one's aesthetic needs. So from this six, how does the school play the role? Very simple. I mean, I have the diagram above is also simplified in three. You have the status needs, situation needs, and the security needs. So you start out with the security, then you create the next two level, stimulation and the status. Okay, so that's the three levels. Okay, for example, let's go through one by one. The survival needs, food, water, and rest. Particularly in environment where you're catering for disadvantaged students. Nutrients, food, and water are crucial. Can you imagine if you are sitting in a low-income neighborhood where children miss their breakfast, And here you are talking about quadratic equations or teaching the constitution or declaration of independence, and that guy hasn't had his breakfast. How much attention is he going to face? Or another still, you could be a lecturer teaching some fundamental concepts of civil engineering through someone at 2 o'clock in the afternoon who has just had his meal and is struggling to stay awake. See, the concept is to take into account the need, the survival needs. Okay, then you talk about safety. Students must feel safe. I mean, they must come to class and know that nothing is going to happen to them. So they can rest their mind that to pay attention to what you are talking to them. They can completely be assured. So I'm sure certain parts of the world, this is not possible. And even in the best of places and best of times, this is not possible. I mean, bullying is a major issue that takes place in every part of even the most enriched environment. I mean, you could be in Garden International School where the best of the best and the most affluent school attend. They will be still prone to bullying if it goes unchecked. Belongingness. Now, this is where the school plays a role. The participants of the community must feel that they are part of the community. Only then they will uphold the traditions and traditions of the community wholeheartedly. If you need participation, people will only participate if they feel they are part of it. So this is a very important part in how we organize our class. If you organize the class and you come up with rules and regulations that doesn't include the opinion and desire of the participants, why would they willingly participate? So in many successful teachers, especially the younger level teachers, they do organize classroom rules and regulations incorporating students' feedback or students' input on how to do certain things. Esteem, recognizing and feeling a worthwhile. Now, this is very important for especially the higher level, in the sense that I could come to your class, I do my work, I submit my assignments, you impersonally mark and give me feedback. Although feedback helps me, but I don't want to feel that I'm part of a system. I would like to feel that I'm part of a community. And that is really a big thing, especially with e-learning, because now we have less and less contact. I will have an inbox, I electronically hand in my assignment, someone marks it and electronically put my feedback into some system, and I could feel impersonal. And I need to feel worthwhile. I mean, getting a few marks here and there is great, but at the end of the day, I need to feel this appreciation that will encourage me to go on and jump in deeper and give better work. Esteem, okay? And then knowing and understanding needs. This is a great desire of human that occurs naturally that we need to capitalize. Humans have a natural desire to learn. They have a natural desire and tendency to want to understand things. So capitalizing the human inquiry is an important issue, an important tool that teachers should use to facilitate teaching and learning. And finally, everyone needs to actualize themselves. They need to reach, they will have a natural desire to reach the fullest potential. So how the school and the system or the community should participate to give everybody their unique space, to not to come on with a single ruler and measure everyone, but to have various rulers that give everybody a measurement to stack up against the odds.